Now, just how great were the great train robbers?
Well, they're not that great because they got caught.
Well, yeah. I mean, they got so caught. They got caught almost immediately.
Yeah.
And they got caught in very stupid ways. Do you know how they were caught? They went to this farm and played Monopoly using the stolen money as their Monopoly money. And then they cleared out and left their fingerprints over everything, over all the Monopoly set. And they were all, you know, they all had form. They were all, you know, known blaggers. So they were just rounded up, all 12 of the gang of 15. One was acquitted, two were never caught. They were pretty inept, is the answer, basically. Who's the most famous of the great train robbers, would you say? Ronnie Biggs, yeah. And what was his role? Was he the mastermind? Is that why he's the best known?
No.
No, he was such a small peg in the whole thing.
Was he the driver?
No, he wasn't even that. He was inside. He was doing a stretch for taking and driving away. And the mastermind of the entire event met him and said, I'm planning this blag.
I'm planning a game of Monopoly.
Yeah,
planning
a game of Monopoly.
That's he's just exactly. Got to pick something up on the way.
Yeah,
it's
exactly.
My set, I've lost all the fake money. And the only way of replacing it I can think of...
is I rang Waddington's, they didn't want to know. Get a new set, they said. Don't be ridiculous, I said.
Anyway, the mastermind was called Bruce Reynolds. And he said, if you can find me someone who can drive a train, a diesel train, I will cut you in on a big job that's going down.
You can find... I mean, it's not, that's like the, I mean, that's not like someone who can sort of melt diamonds with their eyes. It's someone who can drive a diesel... Apparently they exist somewhere.
But the amazing thing, David Mitchell, is... that Biggs found this guy whose nickname was Old Pete or Stan Aggett. No one knows who he was because he was the one who was never caught.
Oh, was that Old Pete the train driver? And I know.
Yeah. So his job... Right,
after Casey Jones had turned him down.
Yeah. For this, for being found, Ronnie Biggs got a share worth 147,000, which in today's money is 1.6 million. And all he had to do, Ronnie Biggs, was get this guy, Old Pete, to the scene. But this Old Pete got to the train and said, oh, I don't know how to drive that. Well, Big still got his share, but the Old Pete was useless. He couldn't drive a train. He'd been lying all the time.
I like the idea that Old Pete's like those actors who put on their CV, yes, I can horse ride. Oh, yes, I can drive a train. I speak Mandarin, too. Straight through China, no problem at all.
He found him. He went through Spotlight. Yeah. And the other, apparently, he was very well reviewed. Yes. Much Ado About Nothing last year.
And he's trained in modern dance.
Yes.
That could come in handy. Well, the great train robbers weren't particularly great. Most of them were caught because they left fingerprints on the Monopoly set at the safe house.
What is this island called?
Newfoundland.
Yeah. I'm going to have to shoot you now. No, it isn't the correct pronunciation.
Newfoundland.
Hey, enough violence on this show.
Yeah. Newfoundland is the correct pronunciation, and in 1876, a man was killed during a brawl over the correct pronunciation.
Oh, we were lucky, weren't we?
Got two mill workers, William Aitchison and John Davis, one thought it was Newfoundland and one thought it was Newfoundland. Aitchison threw a punch, Davis drew his gun and killed Aitchison. He got away, Davis, and he spent 37 years on the run. So there's a really...
Davis?
Yes, Davis.
Any relation?
Yeah. Possibly.
John Davis, dangerous man.
I had a great uncle who emigrated to Canada.
Did he go to Newfoundland?
Newfoundland.
I think he went to Newfoundland. Quebec, actually.
And you inherited your shirt from him.
Anyway, just to finish the story... Davis, who killed Aitchison, he ran away for 37 years, and then on his deathbed, 1912, he's in a hospital in Brioria in Illinois, and he feels so bad about it that he confesses on his deathbed, and then recovered and had to go on the run again.
I think he said, I did that murder in Newfoundland. No, it's Newfoundland!
What sentence would you recommend in Jedwood justice?
Life.
I feel very sorry, Ever Reach. We're giving you all kinds of cultural references that can mean nothing to you. Have you heard of Jedwood?
Yeah. Are they judges? They look very young.
I believe Irish. Are they twins?
They can join twin judges.
They're not conjoined.
Well, they've done well, haven't they?
I don't know.
The whole thing about us, the whole point of them is they're conjoined.
Are they?
They're conjoined twins, yeah.
No, it looks like they are.
Josh, come on!
Who has the arm in the middle?
They do look a little strange, I have to say, but that's probably because of the wig business.
No, no. Nothing to do with the wig. Okay.
But anyway, there really is such a thing as Jedward Justice. This predates these twinsters.
Maybe that's where they got the name from, really.
Oh, I don't think so, really. This is a town which was originally called Jedward, and then it changed its name to Jedburgh. It still exists. Jedburgh, you may have heard of it.
In the northeast.
It is. It's on the borders, in fact. It's a border town, and that's the clue, really. The borders, as you know, suffered throughout history. Incursions and raids from England, raiding through Scotland, stealing, and vice versa. And they were often summarily hanged without a trial, and it was known as Jedward Justice. And our name for that, where someone is especially killed without a trial, is what word do we use for that?
Oh, lynch mob.
Lynch. Now, where does the word lynch... Why is it called lynch?
I have absolutely no idea.
Well, there's a claim to the origin of the term lynch, which is a man called James Lynch Fitzstephen, who was the mayor of Galway in Ireland. And he hanged his own son from the balcony of his house after convicting him of the murder of a Spanish visitor in 1493. Wow. So that's pretty bold, isn't it?
Wow. It's on a bike.
It's extreme. He learned his lesson. He never did it again. No.
Did you say hang his own son for stealing a bike?
No.
No!
What did you think I said?
I misheard you because I was so hungry. I can't concentrate when I'm hungry.
Killing a Spaniard.
For killing a Spanish visitor, yeah, Spaniard.
Do you not listen to him?
No, he doesn't.
I'm starving hungry.
Are you?
And now I can't concentrate because I'm having a blood sugar crash.
I never get called up for jury service and you're hungry in the afternoon. What was it, kill a Spaniard or stole a bike?
Quite an important
starving. Yeah, can I get an apple?
Where did that come from?
I don't know.
Stole a bike.
Your mind was wandering.
Up, I was thinking about pasta.
When his brain sugar drops, I'm afraid all kinds of weird things start to happen.
Well, has no one got something to eat here? Can we not?
Are you bringing something down?
Here you go. Come on.
Thank you very much.
Flapjack.
Oh, flapjack. Oh, thank you. Yeah, go on.
Oh, she has to be good. Very good.
This is a human optogram. What does it prove?
I always thought optograms was that thing where they could look in your eye and see who had murdered you.
What now?
This is like before, like, DNA and stuff. And they were like, oh, no.
We always had DNA. It's really... Before we knew about it.
Yeah, so I'm a Victorian policeman. This woman's died. I know. We'll get her eyes out, have a look on the retina. The last thing she's seen, that'll be the killer.
Was that like a commonly held...
Well, it began in the 17th century, so there was a priest called Christopher Schiner, and he claimed he had seen the image of a flame on the retina of a frog that he had been dissecting. So then you get the development of photography, so that's about 1840s, and that seemed to provide a sort of theoretical basis for this notion. There was a German physiologist called Wilhelm Kuhn. 1878, he immobilized a rabbit and forced it to look at a window for 3 minutes, and then he decapitated it, cut open the eye, and the next day he said that the retina dried and revealed an image of the window. That was the last thing that the rabbit had been staring at.
Bullshit.
Right. So he was able to... he was able to reveal that he killed the rabbit. That's a bit of luck. I could have saved him a bit of time there.
1880, he decided to repeat this experiment with the head of a guillotined murderer, a man called Erhard Gustav Reif. And his left eye was dissected 10 minutes after he died. And the resulting optogram is that picture that we saw at the very beginning.
So
and
it has
been, yes, it's been suggested it's the blade of the guillotine. It seems very unlikely he was blindfolded at the time.
the last bit of toast he had.
Yeah. Unfortunately, all we have is that sketch. We don't have the actual image. So this idea about optograms was taken up by fictional writers of Jules Verne and some of the popular press, and it appears, because this was widely believed, that some killers took the precaution of taking their victims' eyes with them to make sure there was no...
They seem really principally to be concerned with her hat in that picture.
Yes.
Where's her hat? I think it's over there!
for watching. Do remember to subscribe to the QI channel and click here to watch more videos. Please, come on, pick something.